I'd like to proceed by introducing the first speaker, Alexander Zehnder. When Alexander, or Sasha, is at his apartment in NTU, in Nanyang Technological University, he's my neighbor. And he's a very good neighbor because he, like I, likes wine, cheese, and exploring and discussing problems that span literature, culture, science, and university, and other big and small problems that our world is keeping itself busy with. And apart from the fun and the wine, he brings to those discussions a tremendous knowledge, experience, and wisdom in dealing with a wide range of such issues all around the globe. Sasha is a world leader when it comes to issues like water policy, the nexus between water, energy, and food security, water safety, and infrastructures. So he is uniquely qualified to address the issue of disruptions in the water systems that support modern society. So please join me in welcoming Sasha.
Yeah, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. What actually Jan forgot to say is that when we are discussing about the world, so we actually change the world. The only problem is that the world never hears about it, and the next morning it's the same world we find back, which we left before we went to bed. So, but it's good to have this kind of discussion. What I would like to talk to you to this morning is about the water issues. I'm somehow reluctant to say that we are kind of close to the abyss or so. It is it's not so. It is unwillingness of the people and those organizing and governing the people to really deal with the water issue in most countries. It's not so in this country, and I will come back to that also. It is, we have only a few countries around the world who are really looking into the water issue. But let me start with a point which all sounds logical to you, but actually complicates the solution of the water challenges. If you look at the major religions and beliefs and philosophies around the world, water is everywhere an absolute central element. So I will not go into more details about that, but the thing is, water is not an intellectual issue. Water is an emotional issue. And because it's so strongly emotional, it became part of the religions and philosophies. And because of that, obvious solutions cannot always be taken or resolved or found, and this comes in our way. So we have heard about many of the other topics which are probably a little bit more you can approach in an intellectual way. Water, basically, you have to approach, if you want to find real solutions, you have to approach it from an emotional point of view. So, but what are, basically, so if you look at the water issue, they all look very simple and straightforward. Not simple, but straightforward. And I just summarized here the great challenges in the water area. So we have, we need good water quality for a growing population on the globe. We will talk about that. We have to have enough food for all. To produce food, we will have water. We'll go into the details of that as well. We need also kind of a distribution between humans and ecosystem, which is specifically an issue in the developed world. It's less in the developing world because they still fight with these two issues, so they have no time to think about the ecosystems. Then we have solution for water conflicts and a fair share of water for all. We go into that also. And then water-induced disasters, disaster protection. And last but not least, water infrastructure. We have, that's probably the biggest investment humans did in the past is investing into water infrastructure. However, we don't see it. It's the pipes in the grounds and all these kind of things. We have big countries struggling to be able to keep actually this water infrastructure running. If you remember, Obama said we were going to invest a lot of money to kind of overcome the financial crisis in 2009 by investing into infrastructure. Little to nothing happened. And Trump actually basically said, I will really deal with the infrastructure. We'll see whether this will happen or not. I doubt, because we all don't really know it. And if we are not dealing with it, we will be hit somewhere down the road. And all, specifically the developed world, is really, this is an asset which is huge and we're not taking care of it. And we come back to that later in the talk. So why are these big water challenges around the world? Why is that so? Well, we have heard it yesterday and I show it once again. We have the demographic trajectory. We have the same amount of resource which has to be distributed among more people. Every person, in addition, on this globe uses of this resource water. And if you don't have enough and you add more people, so you will have an even bigger crisis. However, there is an interesting, actually, development here. If you hear, you see kind of the use of the resources. This is the line which... It's not drawn to the same amount, scale here, but this is the population increase, but this is the GDP increase. What we see is actually the GDP increase is faster than the population, which is a good thing. That means we are getting more wealthy, globally seen, but it has also a drawback. The more money we have, the more we spend, the more resources we are using. So it's not only the amount of people, but also the means the people have at their disposition becomes more. And that's why it actually it's used more. And then we have here the resource and consumption index here, the human welfare ecological footprint. You see here the ecological footprint increases as you go on the development. If you are you're low in the development, your footprint is small. And then you get bigger here, the US, Australia, Canada, Norway, they're all up there. Interestingly, this sector here is basically where we have a minimum criteria for sustainability, and the only country in here is Cuba. So Castro did something right. Not everything right, but he did certain things right. And it's interesting that actually the development of Cuba is so high, and it actually don't use so much resources. So I don't say that we have all to become like Cuba, but there are certain aspects maybe we can learn from there. It's not everything bad if you go back. So that's one thing. It's the population trajectory, and it is the faster rate of increase of the GDP. The second one is when we talk about climate change, we all talk about temperature increase. But if we have global warming, if the temperature increases, the basic effect is on water. So if you want to, the trigger is CO2, the effect is water, period. Don't go into all kinds of other things, because we have all hands full of to do if we can handle that. That means we can act either on the water side and protect human societies for the disasters together with the water, or we can mitigate the CO2. And we have seen in the last 25 or 30 years that actually mitigating the CO2 is difficult. Politicians tell you everything. Great Britain, once under Tony Blair, declared 80% cut of CO2 release in 2050, zero to 2100. It's easily said. You have to do it. That's the other thing. However, in the meantime, global change is actually taking place, and I call it global change, not so much climate change. Climate change is part of it, because the population increase and all these kind of things come together. That's part of the global change. So we will be affected by water issues, being floods or droughts or other catastrophes, much more in the future. And actually, what is affected here, you see that agriculture and forestry, so it will hit our food, it will the cities and rural areas, one big flood is billions of dollars of cost, human health because of the water quality, coastal zones which are eroded, general infrastructure, whatever you build, if it's flooded or whatever happens with water there, that the infrastructure is destroyed, natural ecosystems suffer, tourism and recreation. So basically our life is affected by global change, and the effector is water. So if we can handle that, that means if we can adapt to this, to the water issues in the future, we have done half of the homework. The temperature still will increase, but at least we make the human societies more resilient. We know what to do. It's no big deal. We know exactly what to do. We knew in, for example, New Orleans, that we have to increase the dam and make the dam solid. However, there are other political priorities, and so it needed Katrina to hit, actually. And people started to wake up and say, now we have to do. The problem is these disasters will happen. They come faster than we think, and they will cost much more, 100 times more than if we would fix the problem before it happened. So these are the two points. So it's the trajectory, the demographic trajectory, and it is this close coupling between climate change and water. And that water is the issue in this whole thing. And you see that actually if you look at the numbers here, you have the number of all disasters here, earthquakes. But if you look a little bit closer, the earthquakes are here. So the highest amount of money which has to be spent by insurance companies is actually basically about floods and water issues, and it's much less about all the other disasters. So the water disaster will cost us in the future a lot of money. But we can do something. It's not so that it's just lures around. We have countries like the Netherlands, where Jan is coming from, and some other guests here, they have learned the hard way about 500 years ago to start to deal with water. We have other places in the world where water is an issue. Here, Singapore, we have had to handle the water also. Flooding has been taking place also here in the past, but also we don't have enough water for all the activities. We come back to that. Okay, so water is really a central issue, also if we talk about global change. Now, so these are kind of the generality, and I would like to walk you through a few facts of water, that we know what we are talking about, and not kind of water is so important, and water, this is easily said, I can make a lot of sentences and phrases, but I would like to give you some numbers that you understand what we really talk about here. So basically, we make a difference between two types of water. Both are H2O chemically, but we have kind of what we call the blue water and the green water. The blue water is what you would understand underwater. What you have in the bottle here is blue water. The water in lakes is blue water. The water in the river. So the liquid water you can use for all kinds of things, hygienic drinking, watering your lawn, washing your car, whatever. The water you use daily, that's what we call the blue water. And then we have the green water. And the green water is the humidity of the soil. And actually, that's in volume much more than actually the blue water. And plants wouldn't grow. We couldn't produce food if we would not have also green water. Sure, we can irrigate and all these kind of things. But even heavily irrigated areas around this globe only irrigate with 35% of the water. The rest is green water, the water bound in the soil, which can only be used by the plants. And we cannot dig a hole if you are not hitting the groundwater, but we cannot suck out the humidity out of the soil, and you don't want to do it. It doesn't taste so good if you have the mouth full of soil. So, So this is the what we call then the green water. You find in the literature also black water and gray water. But basically, black water is contaminated blue water from human feces, and gray water is also contaminated blue water by households or by the industry, and so that's gray water. So all these other colors you can always transfer with some energies, with some technology into blue water. So the basic difference is really between green and blue water. And you see then the water, kind of the green water, is water which is in the soil. It is evapotranspirated by forests, by grassland. It evaporates from rivers or from cropland. So this is all green water, basically as a rumen of thumb, which may be different in different places, but just to give you a feeling, if you have the water actually hitting the ground, is 100% drain, we transfer about 2/3 into green water and about 1/3 into blue water. So this is the blue water which we are using. The green water is just there to make sure that actually the environment remains green. Now, what is the difference? So if you look at the mobility, blue water is mobile, green water is immobile. Source of substitution, we can actually substitute it at the blue water, but we can impossibly the green water. Competitive use, the blue water is many. It's human consumption, it's industry, it's environment, it's ecosystems. Green water, basically, it's only the plant. Convenience facility, we can actually bring blue water from one place to the other. It is actually not possible and not required to transport green water. It's either there or gone. The cost of use is high because that's where we transport and treat. Low, we don't have to do anything. It's there and will be used by the plant. So these are, you will see then it later on, it has a slight difference between these two waters, and we have to make sure that we understand that. And now the next step is, I will concentrate mostly onto the blue water in the first steps, because that's the water, when we talk about water, that's the water issues we all talk about. And how much water do we really require as humans? So let us look at the numbers. And it's interesting. There has been a publication in 92 by Falkenmark and Wittström, and Falkenmark is the old lady of the water system and also of the Stockholm, one of the initiators of the Stockholm Water Prize. They had already there, by just analyzing the globe and looking kind of how much blue water is available per capita and year, they found that approximately 1,500 to 1,700 cubic meter is needed per person and year, then you have sufficient water. This is huge. Can you imagine? This is 1,700 tons of water per year. We all use. If water stress when you are below that, scarcity when you are below 1,000, and extreme scarcity when you are over 500. So this is easy. Now we have to see for what we use this water. What do we really need? For what do we need this water? Here, the water requirement for people, services, and industry, it is the blue water. We look at it. The first part is drinking water. How much water do we drink? Depending on where you live, in the temperate zones, maybe three liters. Here in the tropics, you can go up to about 9 liters if you have to work outside the whole day. That means if you calculate how much water you need per year, it's 1 to 3 cubic meter. It's nothing. What is the whole fuss about it? We have enough water on the globe to give everybody enough to drink and so. However, it has to be good quality. We cannot drink any water. And still now, waterborne diseases is the number one killer in the world of humanity. So more people die on waterborne diseases than on anything else around the globe. But we need also water to kind of for our hygiene. So that means about approximately 30 to 50 liter, which for cooking and taking a shower and washing our clothes. So all together, if you want to, as one of the rule of thumb for take home message, for survival, we need about 20 cubic meters of water for a decent life, 20 cubic meters of water, a liquid blue water to survive. However, in the meantime, we also water lawns, we wash cars, we do all kinds of things. So that we need more water here. So that goes up, it's much higher. Services, this means restaurants, hospitals, and so we all use them also. They wash and clean, and so they need more water. It can go up to almost 140, all calculated per capita and year, industry as well. So there was a long discussion, specifically in the 80s and the 90s, to make water a human right. Now, nobody said really what the human right actually comprises. I would say to fill up your swimming pool is not basically a human right. However, what you need is the survival, this 20 cubic meter per person in the year. That's, say, a social good or, in quote, human right. And the UN is in the meantime there. It's still contested. But about this is the minimum amount you have to use. It's very interesting. One of the first countries in the world who actually recognizes that you have different uses of water is South Africa. And South Africa has different tariffs for the water on that level and the water on that level. And if we talk about something economic and you have to pay for, we all agree this is the water we have to pay for, or at least for the service to get it. Here, we don't, because it is the base of our life. And water has no price. You can go out and get a bucket of water. Nobody's going to charge you for it. But it's for the service to deliver. You have your high quality 24 hours, 7 days a week. For that service, you have to pay. And this is the amount. And South Africa was the first country introducing that, to have a lower tariff on that, an increasing tariff if you use water for all kinds of other activities. There are a few other countries like Tunisia and so are going in that direction. I think that's a good way. So basically, if you want to, how much blue water do we really need? Let me first go into the treatment, sorry. So can we, that water we have been talking about has to be very good quality, and still we get waterborne disease. Why is that? So we have the technology. Nobody has to tell me that we don't have the technology. We have very simple technology, starting with solar water disinfection. The only thing you need is, I'm sorry to say, a plastic bottle. So because plastic bottles are under pressure and it's not sexy to use plastic bottles, so we have them all on the table. And so, but plastic bottles can actually be very helpful if you are poor and living out somewhere in the field. What you have to do is just to fill up the bottle with a clean bottle, plastic bottle with water, expose the water to the sunlight, and it's biologically safe after 6 hours of sunlight. We understand exactly the molecular mechanism, what's going on, and how the bugs are killed. So it's very interesting scientifically what's going on. So it's the UV light of the sun, but it's also the shortwave blue light, which actually kills this box in the water. And so you can actually treat. If you go around, you're lost somewhere, you have a bottle, so you can take actually water from any source, expose it to 6 hours to sunlight, and it's safe to drink, biologically. The chemicals are still in there. Or we can go to very sophisticated areas, and depending what you are, if you're a big city, you're rich and so, you can pay a lot of money to make a reverse osmosis or something like that. So everything in between, and there are other possibilities in between. So we have the technology, we have the engineering know-how, we have the scientific background to treat the water, to drinking water quality. And there is no reason why we should not do it. It's there, we have the solutions, we just have to use that solution. So, and we can, it's very simple. Here is a small story to this thing here. This doesn't cost anything. You know, Nestle, Danone, Coca-Cola, and so they distribute almost free of charge these plastic bottles around the world. So everybody has a plastic bottle. And wherever you are in Africa, South America, you go in Central Asia, plastic bottles are around. So you can treat your water. And you can treat your water in, say, in the northern hemisphere, in the southern hemisphere. You don't have to be in the tropics alone. It's treatable if you are on the Andes, on the Himalaya, and so this technology works. And poor people are starting to use it. But about 2 billion people do not really have water of the right quality. And we know in the meantime that only about 30 million people are using this technology. There is no economic incentive to distribute this technology around the world. Nobody wants to do that because they don't get anything out of it. We had tried for years and years, and I invested, my institute at the time invested probably close to about 20 or 25 million only to bring this knowledge around in the world. You have to go to village, you have to preach, you have to tell them, you have to show them, and so every individual has to be worked at. So we thought it's just an easy thing. We invite Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola looks at the technology and then actually puts on the etiquette on the bottle, and everybody knows it and can use it. I've never had a due diligence of that intensity. The Coca-Cola people were sleeping in the lab to make sure that nobody's going to touch anything, so that it's not under their control. 2 weeks, they were in the lab, living in the lab, make sure that nothing happens. At the end, they said, you're right. It works. And then they talk to their lawyers, and the lawyers say, no way. The problem is not so much the developing world. It is if somebody in the US uses this method, doesn't mess a little bit around and get sick, maybe not from the water, but from something else, but would say and then start to sue the company, reputational damage, huge. So guys, we financed the whole research, but unfortunately, we cannot put it on the bottle, imprint of the bottle. So we have no method to actually bring technologies which are at no cost to all those who need it. It is this information channel, if there is no economic incentives behind it, doesn't really work. So How is the difference? We looked at the amount of water used around the globe. I just put here together in a simple graph. This is the amount of blue water which people use in the US. It's about 370 cubic meters. The Europeans actually use a bit less. If you look, they probably shower only once a day and not twice or three times a day. And this here is not, this is really something here. This is Africa. So Africa goes down to about 25 cubic meters. So if you take the entire African continent and you calculate how much water the people are actually using and is at their disposal, it's about the minimum amount of water for survival. But we are still far away from the 1715 to 1700. Where is the rest of the water going to? Here we see the water use, and the big part, if you see, goes into agriculture. This is industrial use, and the shaded area is kind of the water contamination. This is what you can clean up with technology. This is the domestic use. This is reservoirs evaporation. But this is the huge water consumer. Growing a plant uses a lot of water. If you have a plant at home, in your living room, you should start to measure how much water you give to that plant for the plant to grow. And you will be surprised how much it is. Now, what I did here is I went into the literature and looked what are the numbers in the studies in these 15 years between 1996 and 2011 for producing staple food. That means wheat, rice, and maize or corn for the North Americans. And what you see is then there's different studies here, and this is in areas where we use actually water for irrigation. So the studies here, we got the mean, but the interesting thing here, what it boils down to, the overall medium, is wheat. To produce 1 kilogram of wheat,
we need 1,000 kilograms of water or 1 cubic meter. So it's a factor of 1,000. If you produce rice, you need more water because you produce, the water productivity is lower. So it's about 0.9. If you don't have water, grow maize, because maize is much more water efficient. That has something to do with the biochemistry of the plant, because it's a C4 plant, so it actually doesn't lose so much water in photosynthesis, and it's very efficient. And it's interesting, in the 90s, when China started to struggle in the growth and didn't really, and had to import a lot of food, the government has decided, based on a study which has been coming out of the World Resource Institute of the water use in China, they switched almost, not entirely, but a large part of their agricultural production was switched from rice to maize. It was 95, I think, or 96. And if you look at the import of food, 97, 98, drastically almost fell to zero, because the little amount of water was used much more, and more maize was produced. In the meantime, the rice is back, because people became richer. They could actually buy food from the outside and didn't have to produce it inside. But this is actually the take-home message for you, something you should never, ever forget anymore, is this rule of thumb, that want to produce 1 kilogram of bread, you need 1 cubic meter of water. So actually, we are not drinking the water, we are eating it through the food we are using. Now, just to show, this is a very old slide, but it's actually basically interesting. You know, this is all rain-fed agriculture. The productivity is much lower. You need much more water. You need here about 2 to 3 cubic meter to produce 1 kilogram of bread when you take the rain-fed. When you go and irrigate, you come up to this about 1 here, which is the maximum you can achieve. There's another interesting number on this slide, is actually the maximum you achieve at tons of per hectare in grain yields is 8. We don't know why it is, so it's probably a shadowing of the plant, one plant or the other. Nowhere in the world you go far above 8 tons per hectare. That's about the limit, almost the thermodynamic limit in agriculture, if you want to. But as we are not only eating rice and bread or maize, we would like to have a piece of meat. So animals, basically, what they do is they convert about 5 to 15% of the energy which is in their feed into meat. In the average, it's about 10. Chickens are above 10, and cows are a little bit below, and pork as well, but it's about between 15 and 10. Let's just take about 10%. So that means if we want to have the same amount of energy out of the food here, we need about 10 times more water to cover the same amount of energy in the meat than if we would eat, would be only vegetarian or vegans. We come to that. It's actually an interesting number. It's huge. Meat consumption drives water use drastically up. And the link is not so much the farming of the animal, it's just the inefficiency of conversion of plant material. So you say, oh, we make kind of animals which are more efficient. Come on, you know, we would like to convert less than 5% into body weight, because we would like to eat a lot and not put on fat. But basically, also we are there. And we can be happy that we convert only 10%. Otherwise, we could either eat much less, or we all would be blown up a little bit more, which you see in some countries around the world, basically. So if we do a very simple back-of-the-envelope calculation and say, how much energy do we need to survive or to have a decent life? For the stuff of the activities we do here, about 2,000 to 2,500 kilocalories per day is enough. Interestingly, if you look how much actually people are using, is in Europe, we are about at 3,400 kilocalories per day.
And in the US, it's about 4,500. And I always say, you see it. You just walk in the street and you see that actually they are eating double of what they are basically need. So 2,500 is fine. This is a good diet. And if we look at the diet with 20% meat, we come to about 1,200 to 1,500 cubic meter. The difference is a little bit of pre- and post-harvest lost, and so it's just to give you the feeling where this 1,500 to 1,700 come from. This is about 250 blue water, the rest is green water packed into food. If you are vegan, you use much less water here because you only eat plant material, so you're not losing energy and water basically in translating it. So these are numbers which I come back then to see whether we can feed the people for the future on this globe. So that's kind of that's the simple numbers we have been I have shown you here. Now what happens when we are in a country where there is not enough water? And I remember, I gave a talk, I think it was in 2000 or 1998, I'm old, so I'm talking about the past, you know, in Jerusalem. And I haven't really thought the story yet through at that time entirely. And then I was showing these numbers, and then some guys stood up in the audience and said, but Israel can do it with much less water. And I started to scratch in my head and say, so okay, so I have to see whether this is, you know, if they are living on another planet or what are they doing? And then I went into the statistics, and then I looked how much water they do have. And so this is then kind of, this is internal surface, all this is cubic meter per year and per capita, and so if you count all together, it's about 360. So it's severe scarcity. I don't tell you anything new. We know it is severely scarce, the water there. So that's okay. But then I looked, where is the green water? Because people mostly look only on the blue water. So in the agriculture, it's about 65% is rain-fed, even in Israel. And only about 35% in volume is actually irrigated. So still another 100 comes to it. So we are close to 500, say. But we are still extreme scarcity. And then if you look at the water embedded in the food, or what's called now virtual water, which is actually imported into the country, and you see the total amount of imported water embedded in the food is almost double of what you have as blue water there. So the country does actually compensate the lack of the water in the food, the lack of the water in the country by importing food which has been grown with water somewhere else. Now, you can look wherever you want to and look at the statistics. If a country has a little bit less of the water really available, about this 1,500 is about the limit. The moment they fall below, they start to import food. It's one-to-one. And you cannot tell the people you eat in 3 years, you have to feed them the next year, and you have to feed them almost every day. So the effect is immediate. Now, Israel is also a big exporter of agriculture goods. And so if you look at the numbers here, then you see this is the amount of rain falling down, this is evapotranspiration, this is plants and evaporation. So they lose a large part of the water directly into the atmosphere back. So the water is not lost from the surface of the globe, but it's not there anymore where you use it. Then there is water recycling quite a bit, but it's a small amount. The external sources, water comes in. Desalination, very small, fossil fuel. And this small green arrow here, this is the agriculture export. And this one is the agriculture import in volume. So about 6 cubic kilometers of water is imported in form of food, and about 0.4
cubic kilometer per year is exported in goods. So it's a huge amount you bring into it. And now we're sitting here in Singapore. How does that look for Singapore? Did the same calculation. Singapore is even worse. But we knew that. But it's still interesting. This is the rain coming down, evapotranspiration, and actually Singapore is relatively efficient in not losing too much water through evaporation because the water is immediately collected, it's brought into reservoirs, it's brought into the estuarines and so as blue water. We do almost 100% water recycling. There is a little bit of desalination, there is a little bit of runoff, there is a little bit of discharge, but we import about 4 cubic kilometers per year of virtual water into the country. The dependence of Singapore on that part, on the virtual water, is at least as big as it is from the water coming from Malaysia. But basically, Singapore depends on the green waters of the world, and it depends on the blue water of Malaysia, and it can manage the blue water, but it cannot manage the green water. So, because of the sheer difference of the number. And Singapore needs that because the surface is not big enough to produce the food. We have not enough water to do it. So we need actually other countries around the world who have the water and have the land to produce the food to bring it in. So if we talk about water, it's not only the liquid water. It is actually also the water embedded in the food. And it may be even more important to look after that than only to look at the blue water. And then what we wanted to see whether this all have something to do with what we were thinking here and back of the envelope calculation. What you see here is a relatively busy flight, but we looked at the 5 years from 1980 to 84, and then 15 years later, the amount of cereal import into the different countries. And what you here have is the water availability. Here it's 5,000 cubic meter per capita and year. Here this line is about 1,500. And this here is the net import in kilogram of cereals per year. What you clearly see is that line is relatively constant. You always have some import here. But it may be depending a little bit on the country. If you are rich like Japan, you always import more than if you are poor like Syria down here. But you see that line starts to go up immediately once you hit approximately the 1500. And you see then the change. This is the first period. And this is the second period. What you see here, Lebanon, for example, this is increase of population. Israel, increase of population, Jordan, increase, Libya, Tunisia, you're all the North African states, except Egypt. Interestingly, Egypt goes down. What happened in this period is actually they increased the efficiency of their irrigation system. So they are still on the line here, but they came kind of out of the blue here and reduced it to an amount they have to go to. Really poor are those guys down here who don't have the money, don't have the water, and that's also the places where you actually get problems. Zimbabwe, Burundi, this is where we have these big issues and the famines and so. So it is so. Water lacks compensation by food import. That's what you can do. And now, how does that look globally? And this is the situation 2000. What I have drawn simple, you will see a few maps later which are more complicated, but this is just simple, took the countries, the amount of people, the amount of water available, and looked where when they fall below the 1500 cubic meters, then they are red. If they're slightly above or at 1500, they are gray. That means they could theoretically manage. If they are green, they have more water. That means they can use it for agriculture and overproduction for the export. And you clearly see that North Africa is actually the hotspot. This is nothing new. Then you have one pink country here, Japan. Japan just lacks the land. It has enough water, but it lacks the land for the production. And then you have Singapore here, which is red.
But then you have large parts which are green, the exporters, the European Union, basically, Australia, South America, Brazil, Argentina, the US, and Canada. So if you look around the world, who is exporting food? This is these countries. Now, we were interested in actually who are the major exporter of food. Who are the people, or who are the country, or which countries do feed the rest of the world, or compensate for the rest for lacking water? Very interesting. It's only 5 countries. It's the US by far. And this is the total. This is not only wheat export. This is the total export of food or for agriculture good, calculated into cubic kilometers of water per year, net export. The US by far the biggest. Most of it from green water, less from blue water. Number two, still Australia, even when they have droughts, because there's not many people in Australia. They basically still can overproduce food and export it. Number three, who have thought that? Argentina. And we come back to Argentina. Argentina will be important for the world in the future. France, we all knew that. France is feeding the EU, basically. And Canada. And not Brazil. And not Kazakhstan. They are much lower. What are 4 of these big 5 here are in the industrialized north. So basically, the industrialized countries will feed the rest of the world and not the developing world. And many economists have always written articles about it. The food will come from the developing world. Forget it. They have too many people, not enough water, and that's it. It will come from these guys here. And you can imagine now what kind of power this is. We sell you food, we don't sell you food. And one of these 5 is using that political weapon of I sell you food, I don't sell you food. And this is the US. And this is the issue here. We do produce enough food around the world, basically. If we would have an absolutely free market where everybody has access to it. We do not have it. It's geopolitics. The food market for smaller countries like Singapore is relatively easy because Singapore is kind of streamlined and gets the food. If you take extreme positions, at least one of them will tell you, we sell you the food or we don't. And this distorts a lot of the issues we have in the food market. An international organization like FAO, who actually should control that and be able to make it accessible for everybody, are not really doing it. It's a political organization. It's not a totally detached organization for political issues. So that's one of the things. And where is this food all going to, which is produced here? It goes to mostly you have the US, you have Canada, you have Argentina, Australia, you have a little bit of the European Union here, specifically France, goes to Russia, China, India, North Africa, goes to Mexico, interestingly. So the maize here, wheat here, comes from the US, and also parts of South America. So there is actually where the water is going to in form of food. This is kind of the global trade of water. Of virtual water. How does the situation look in 2030? Just take the numbers of the increase of the population, not taking into account climate change, we come to climate change, not taking that into account, the numbers of countries increase, Africa specifically, Eastern Africa, India and China get pink. Why do they get pink? Basically, they have enough water, but they would have to dam all the rivers to make the water available for agriculture production. Now, you hear the discussions out in the world. Damming is the worst thing what it is. It is not. At the end of the day, we have to dam the rivers if we are not using them for transport and as an ecosystem if we want to feed this world, because the water is going running down the rivers into the ocean. You better keep it back and use it for the agriculture, for the food production. So if they would dam all the river, they can actually still feed their own people. If they are not damming it, they will be they have to import food for the near future. And now we have been talking about climate change here, and climate change is kind of like the Damocles sword out there. Whatever we know now is it, but it changes when the climate change does. So what we did the global modeling on that, and this is the picture you get. What you see here is 2030, and we looked at the sum of the staple food. So wheat, maize, and rice, so that's the big part. So that's where you keep the people alive. And we looked at what happens 2030 and what happens in 2019. Now, you know, all this climate change modeling and so it's not predictive. It's a scenario, just to give you a feeling that we are not, these points, whether they have a certain color or so, can actually also change. We take a few initial assumption, and from there we calculate, and the assumption described the scenario. But what we did here is really taking all this assumption into account. When you are brown, you have a problem. When you are dark blue, it increases the productivity. If you are brown, it decreases with high confidence, and every color in between is kind of decreasing, increase, and decrease here. But what's interesting thing here is, yes, Africa still is good here. This part, Eastern Europe, into the Soviet, Russia, is still blue. We have parts here, also China is not in bad shape. Part of India is good, but part of India is really in bad shape. Interestingly, the US here, the Midwest, we know that it gets drier, less agriculture production, but in the Western states, it should be good, and specifically in the East, Northeast here. Interestingly, if you look at the Pampas of Argentina here, they are dark blue. That means climate change triggers more water into Argentina, and Argentina will be probably one of the big breadbaskets of the world in the future. It looks a little bit more complicated if we go in 2090. The southern part of the U.S., the Midwest, dries out, but it goes more into Canada, so Alberta is happy here. They will be even more producing wheat for spaghetti production in the world. Argentina is still good. Really in bad shape is India. So India is the critical continent in the future. Africa is also critical, but because of other reasons. We will see that. So you see China is good, Manchuria here, the upper part of China is good. That's just the fertile soil. So if you'd make the entire calculation over it, it's not so that we are running into a big disaster. There is a shift in productivity around the world. So, and we actually did the calculation. I can tell you, even in 2090, if we take all the factors into account, we can, is basically we do not produce the food anymore in the same places we did before, but there are other places which become more fertile because the rain pattern shifts, and if the temperature goes warm, that means we can even produce further up north. And these pictures here, this is kind of the harvest area of wheat. This is the percentage, this is the latitude, here is the equator, this is where we are, so we are not really producing wheat here around, but we use a lot of rice. And what we see then is actually 2030, the distribution about the same. We see that it goes further up north here in the wheat production, and that's specifically in the north where we have the land mass. Maize also, but rice specifically, you see huge, we get a tremendous shift in areas where we can actually grow rice to the higher latitudes, in the south and in the north. Specifically there where actually the humidity will increase. So basically not alarming, and don't only show the Midwest of the US if you talk about the future of the food. Think about Argentina, think about other parts of the world. It actually can be done. It's not so that we are running into the disaster. We are only running into disaster if we are not doing anything. But if we are adapting and going the right direction, it actually, there is
thoughts for hope. I have to be a little bit positive, otherwise everybody is negative here. So, okay. So now let's go to the how many people can we feed? So this is also a simple calculation. I know it's all complications underneath it, but I would like to know, is it basically possible? Is it physically possible to grow enough food for the amount of people looking at the land and the soil and looking at the amount of water? And this is a very simple calculation. Once again, 2,500 kilocalories per person per day. Here, this line is if you are vegan, and this line is if you eat 20% of meat in your diet. And this is about the minimum amount of water we have available, blue water around the world for agriculture use. This is the maximum. We are not, this is kind of the uncertainty, but let's stay in the green area. Where are we now globally? This is the red line of the water use. This is the billion of people around the world. We are now about 7 billion people. So this kind of curve we have seen. We have seen them in all kinds of pictures before. This kind of curves going like that. This is the bad news. It's the same story over again. The good news is we can either do nothing and the curve goes up. That means we start to have huge problems in about 10 to 15 years because of the way we are feeding ourselves and these curves just grow like that. However, we still have some time to bend this curve here. So we are still having some meat in our diet, maybe not anymore 20%. We have anyhow about 30 to 40 here, so don't worry about it. We can reduce a little bit. So we can actually bend this curve. And when we come to the end, basically we could easily feed 10 billion people around the world if we do it right. The water is there, the soil is there, we have to be flexible, we have to adapt to the new circumstances. Very short about infrastructure. I said this is the big cost, this is the big asset. I looked at different cities. If they are renewing their infrastructure, you have to renew about 1.3 to 2% per year at the rate. Singapore is good, Amsterdam is good, Zurich is good, Toronto is bad. Munich is bad, London is about the worst place, but we know that the infrastructure is gone because they are not replacing it, and they live kind of the edge of a big disaster, and then you can come with all your parasites coming out of the sewers there, so it is a big thing there. What is the amount of money? The future investment in the water sector. In China, we have to invest about $50 billion in the next 10 years. Just to build up the wastewater treatment plants we have. US, just to keep the water infrastructure, there is already $30 billion. But I just read this morning, anyhow, the Pentagon is throwing out of the window about $2 billion every year, so by over-administrating all the funds, so we can take some of it to kind of fix our infrastructure, would be anyhow better than give it to Pentagon. The EU needs just to kind of obey its current legislation, over 200 billion euro. Switzerland, I calculated, we have to renew our infrastructure. It's about 150 billion Swiss francs, which is about the same as the US dollar. So it's huge amounts of money. It's huge investments which have to be done. The longer we wait, these prices go up. The faster we do it, the better it is at the end of the day. Now, if you look historically what water did to the globe, and what I did here is just looking when in the world we had indications that actually water infrastructures were in place. And looking at our world now, we know if we have not a body of management of the water infrastructure, nothing will happen. That means you have to have a certain degree of organization in a country to keep the water infrastructure running. Because everybody of us wants to have the water. We don't want to give it to the neighbor. But if we are not giving it to the neighbor, he cannot produce. If you have agricultural areas, you need to share the water. So that means you have to have a governance structure to run this thing. And if you go back in history, it started in Mesopotamia, where we have kind of the first infrastructures, about 8,000 years before present. This is when agriculture started, about 10,000 years ago, and here we see the first structures. Nile, we all know, the Pharaonic empires were built on the water. Basically, it's the management of the water which did it. And they seem to do it right, where in Mesopotamia they had some problems. The Sumerians had some problems in the beginning because they didn't really know how to irrigate, really. But still, it was there. We have huge powers for almost 6,000 years. The River Nile for 1,500 years. But interestingly, the Andean Calderas, we find also this kind of structures. Peru, probably about 6,000 years ago. Mesoamerica, about 6,000 years ago. Indus Valley started about 6,000 to 5,000 years ago. When it started, here is your picture here. This is a swimming pool out of one of the centers there, not 5,500 years ago, about 3,000 years ago. China, about 4,000 years ago. Persia, about 3,500. Arizona, and then I stopped at about 3,000. We all know, and you will hear in the next talk, very probably, about the water management then in this part of the world, and the Khmers. And so interesting is, except Mesoamerica, all are arid zones. These are not arid zones. So these are wet zones. And there, it's not so much that actually you needed a central power to manage the water scarcity, but you needed a power to manage the flooding. So if you looked back to the Mayas, and so it was largely for the flooding, and then they started to run into a lack of water, and then they didn't have an infrastructure to deal with it, and that wiped them out. So very often what you see is actually high human culture, high organization has been built on water because it was the question of survival. You have to have a structure, a governmental structure to do so. So that actually put me then into the thoughts is, look, where are we now? It's just another map. Again, green is enough water. Physical scarcity is here where the red zone is. The green, we have enough. But then I overlaid a map here from the Water Development Report, which actually did not only show the physical scarcity, but also what they call the economic water scarcity. That means mismanagement, basically, or non-management at all. And then you see that all of a sudden, green areas, which actually are in good shape here, become dark. Africa. You get parts of South America. You get here in Asia. Northern India, and we all know that, Myanmar, Bangladesh, even they will fix it here, Vietnam, but at the moment they're still not really having their water management in place. That means if you are not managing the water right, then you may also run into water scarcity, not because physically you lack the water, but because you're not running it in the right way. And then I thought, well, there is an index out there in the world looking at governance efficiency. Let's see how that actually connects to the water. And here are the next map. The map you have seen here, this is the dark areas, are actually the badly managed area. And so, and then you see this economic lack of water here. And this is the government efficiency report, which came out in 2005. Actually through the World Bank. It's not the World Bank report, but it's through the World Bank. And what you see is many of these dark blue countries actually turn up a red. That means government efficiency is all close to zero. So it seems, at least by looking at that map, and my experience over the last 20 years have been working with that, we see if governments are efficient, the water issue is managed. If the governments are inefficient, we have water problem, period. So what I'm dreaming of, maybe I will do that in the near future, is making a water management indices reporting. And then I'm sure the water management indices reporting will show you where the governments functions and where they don't.
historically, it has been it has been so. It is now so, and this suggests actually that we are thinking in the right direction, and it will be in the future. If we want to survive as humanity in dignity now without big collateral damage, we just have to learn to manage the water. If we are not able to manage the water, and I think I have shown you that we have still enough, we can do it, but we have to do something. It doesn't come alone. So let me come to the final thoughts before I'm talking much too long. I'm talking already too long. So I hope I have shown you that water is one of the great challenges of the 21st century. So it goes, the effects go actually from local to global. But also that we have the technology and we have the amount of water to solve the quality of water issue. We understand actually basically the relation between water, food, and climate change. So the knowledge is sufficient to take clear actions now. It's not so that we don't know. We know exactly what we have to do. The question is how. And I come then to the last point here, which is important. So what the problem is, the effectiveness of governments and the willingness to actually do handle the challenges of the water. If we are not doing anything, they will persist or even aggravate. And the problem I said to you in the beginning is that water is an emotional element. You cannot approach solutions for water issues in the future just by putting in infrastructure. You have to get the people behind you. You have to have the people who are willing to actually live with these infrastructures and to entertain it. But you cannot just tell them, you know, we have a water issue, we have to build this thing. I would say a lot of industry can tell you stories about it, what actually triggers the water issues, at least. And then, if you look back historically, you know, our ancestors were very clever. Our ancestors put actually the water management into the hands of God. They implemented it into the religion, and that's why it popped up now in the religion. It was probably an intelligent choice of a few very intelligent people to say, if God is actually managing, we can make rules, and these are God's rules, and then people will do it because they are not asking the question. It is emotional. The gods are doing it. And in most countries we have seen, like in Mesopotamia or also in Egypt, the kings, as representative of the gods on earth, had a godlike structure. So they were not questioned. So that's why they got it done. And there, where we didn't have that, it didn't work because people had not this divine inspiration of how to deal with water. And nowadays, what do our politicians do? They want to solve it themselves. It won't work because, except here in Singapore, I always have to make the exception of Singapore, we had almost a very high brain here in the country, Lee Kuan Yew, and he said water is the first priority, and it will remain the first priority forever and ever. It comes almost close to this religious belief. I don't say it is a religious belief, but it is. It puts it at a very high priority, and it works. So somehow we have to figure out how we have to get the inspiration or make sure that the people have the feeling it is inspiration for the future, and then we will have the water issue resolved. Interestingly, when I started to prepare this talk, this is my last slide, I just came across The Economist, and I must say The Economist is intelligent because they think exactly the same way I did, because what they figured out also in November, in their November issue, water scarcity is because it's badly managed. I wouldn't put it so bluntly, but I think it has an important aspect of it. Thanks a lot for your attention.
Trying to evoke a new inspiration from higher sources. Questions? You have about half an hour for discussions. Yes.
Thank you very much for your talk. I'm not sure you were here. I spoke about food and the food system.
No, I wasn't. I'm sorry.
No, I fully agree with you all the way through, other than I would like to cite a note of caution, and that is the climate projections that you're using are effectively underestimating the impacts of extreme weather and the teleconnections between extreme events. And whilst on average there'll be enough food to feed 11, 12 billion people, even with existing diets, the issue that's really coming up to the fore in terms of thinking about food system governance is the fluctuations in the food supply and the risks of multiple breadbasket failure and so on. So we have to distinguish, I think, in terms of the kind of properties, the mean properties of the system and the variance in the properties of the system. And although on average we might be all right, when things go wrong, they could go very wrong towards the end of the century.
I totally agree with you. I have also. We modeled, actually, interestingly for Africa, what we see is the climate change, the extreme event reduce. Actually, it's not everywhere where they increase, but I agree with you. But the extreme events, now that's my point at the end, they are manageable. You can make, during the seven fat years, which we all know the history about it, you can make store, for example, certain things for these dry years. We know that, but that has to be managed. If you are not governing that, you are not able to adapt to this fluctuating situation. I agree with you. My point is, physically, and if we do it right, we can handle it. And we will not have a global drought. We may have a drought in certain continents, and in others we will not have. So we have to be able, on short term, to make switches. I know it's complicated. But my point is, it can be dealt with, maybe not 100%, but we can largely cut the peaks. We know how to shave the peaks. We just don't do it. That's the problem. Well, it will be more expensive anyhow. The moment it hits, it will cost you 10 to 100 times more to repair it. It's better to invest now. But because other things are more important, you have to buy weapons instead of putting it into infrastructure, just to give an example. And so, but at the end of the day, I think the approach which has been taken here in Singapore to put water in this can of water and the food, basically, are on the first priority, because you have to feed the people here, is a very good first step. But I agree with you. The fluctuations are there, but we can sit there and wait and say the gods actually were not happy with us, and so they're punishing us, or we can do something to help them to make it better. Okay. But if physically the water is lacking, we cannot do it.
Roland.
There's a very interesting issue arises from your information about earlier water systems. There are two elements to it, one of which is more significant than the other. The first one is that all the very early water systems were extremely small, and it took on the order of 2,000 years for these societies to start making bigger ones. What has come out of the archaeology of the last 40 years is a very interesting relationship between power, religion, and water. The increasing discovery is that in almost all areas, all irrigation systems are bottom-up managed, not top-down. But religion, as you pointed out, and the connection to water is located right at the top. So in the case of the Khmer, who I work on in Angkor, we have a really interesting situation that the elite write big documents about themselves, they're real big noters, saying that we built these great water management systems. Thereafter, they pay no attention to them at all. And all they're interested in is tax. Mm-hmm. So it appears that what we have are dual systems where you have power at the top, but it's disengaged from the overall running system. And the expectation is that that's a pretty good idea because the people at the bottom know how to do it. What is becoming intriguing, and it deserves a serious sociological study, given your comment about engaging with people and engaging with religions, is that the religion is used as some kind of moderator. And Steve Lansing's work in Bali is the classic example of this, because the priests of the water temples play a crucial role in managing water, but to paraphrase, don't know anything about it. What they know everything about is social relationships. And they mediate the disputes between the heads of the subak, who are the competing water units. So it's actually sorting out that sociology that may in fact become a crucial element of exactly this process of trying to solve how to attach the supply of water to the number of human beings. It's a really major sociological analysis that's required. There's a lot of background material, but it's a tremendously interesting issue.
No, I totally agree, and I don't want to add anything because you said it all. I think the good thing is we cannot say we don't know. We have the facts. The facts are there. We have the technology, we have the facts, we have the knowledge. Now, how to implement it? And then human nature comes in your way. And actually religion, as you say, is the priests. But the priests put a few very basic kind of guiding principles. And nobody questions them. And that's the good thing, because... And then the whole sociology starts to play. And this was the same thing if you look back. The areas governed by the kings and at that time, if you look in Mesopotamia, yeah, it started small and was staying small, but they had first to build a dam. And somebody had to overlook how the dam was built and that it has to be entertained. And then as they grew bigger, probably the management system and the water system grew also bigger because the influence increased. But that's, I'm totally with you there. It's clear.
Okay, we have three questions. Nick first, then the lady over there, and then Peter.
Morning, Nick Gowing. I'm sorry I wasn't here for the first 2 days, but I'm glad to be here now, and I'm going to be talking about thinking the unthinkable. And one of the issues I'd like to raise is this. When you look at what's happened in climate change in the last couple of years only, the proliferation of adopting and adapting to solar and all the sustainables and renewables, there has been a dramatic public shift, including in countries like India. And I was at the Marrakesh summit, the COP22, just a couple of weeks ago, and even with Trump saying, this is just a hoax, there was a distinct sense that everything is moving forward in a very positive direction now because it's a business opportunity. And the reason I say that is because it seems to me that many of the things you're mentioning are about public perceptions and about this being a public issue where the public realize there's a problem. And what you've seen is a bottom-up pressure, including in places like the United States, when it comes to solar and renewable and wind and so on. And I'm just wondering if there is a possibility that there could be a dramatic change on understanding of water and where it's going to come from. I mean, I'm a regular visitor to Singapore. It's been remarkable to see what's happening. And I'm saying, well, if you can have solar panels on roofs, including in tower blocks and so on, in places you would never have imagined, why can't there now be, even if it's retrofitting, the imperative to collect water and to create new systems as ways of overcoming this, including in big cities? Because what you're seeing with 5.8 million people here in Singapore is replicated in many big urban sprawls as well. Or am I being a little just too glossy on this?
Yeah, no, you're totally right, but you are too glossy on it that it is repeated in other places. And I would say not with the vigor of Singapore, absolutely not, and not with this absolute political willingness to have the water cycle under control. And that's why, for example, also here, you cannot collect rainwater as you want to, even if you own a house, because you start to disturb the total system and the total management of the system. So you can have about a cubic meter, but that it ends by them, because then otherwise the whole system is not working because the infrastructure has been put in place. I think we are here in a country who has the highest, by far the highest, almost an art of managing water. So they run now into energy problem because they said energy doesn't count, but at least the water issue is under control. And other cities start to copy that, but they are far away from it. And if you look, for example, on the tariffs, I could go on forever with the values and the economic incentives behind it. If you look at the tariffs around the world, there are only few cities around the world where you actually pay a tariff which takes care of the treatment and the renewal of the infrastructure. Most places, take Kuala Lumpur, you pay a few cents per cubic meter of water. Here you pay almost $3 per cubic meter of water. And I think $3 is not yet covering it really 100%. So the water is subsidized. When you subsidize, nobody cares. Yes, you are right. But I think we are not yet there in many places around the world where we should be and where we could be, and there's a huge effort in that direction. And interestingly, you know, we are trying always to manage these things from top down from the government, but I see now in the energy, you know, we have things like Germany, which turned the whole thing around into renewables. This was a top-down decision. Now they start to run into it. They have to kind of pay for the nuclear power plants and you name it, everything. Infrastructure has to be changed. Where we are much more efficient and much more successful is when the cities do it, because that's the place where you can do it, where people see it, where the people see the effect. And for the water, it's exactly the same, though you still need the hinterland to supply you with food, to supply you with the water which you use in the city. The system becomes a little more complex. But the cities will be the drivers of the future. Not so much the central government. Because they have to do policy in the central government. In the cities, they have to manage. And that's the difference.
Could it be driven by the public?
Yes.
Which is what we're seeing.
Yes. And I think it should be driven by the public. But as long as we have, as long as the city mayors in this world have not a stronger voice, and you can talk to any city mayor, and say, does the national government listen to me? They all tell you they don't. And I think that has to come. And it will. Basically, it will. I agree with you. This is for the drinking water, for the nice water, for the blue water in the city. We have seen it in New York. We have seen it in other areas where actually it was a grassroots movement which changed the things. If you look at the Catskill and whatever happened there, it's a grassroots movement from the city itself. However, when it comes to the link between the water and the food, it becomes much more complicated because you have to include other areas which are outside of your jurisdiction.
Okay, the lady over there.
Hi, Mary Dalele from the National University of Singapore. First, thanks for the talk. I really appreciate that. Instead of pointing the finger at this very like big monster of climate change, you actually point the finger at mismanagement for the issue on water and food. So you said that economic water scarcity, I think in Africa, is mainly to be blamed on government mismanagement. So my question is how to change things. And I'm thinking of three things here. We could think of NGOs or small organizations going on the field. We can think of privatization. Or
of what? What was the second one?
Privatization.
Privatization.
Yes.
Okay.
Or interference by the international community. Because you just mentioned now the intervention of public, but I don't believe that in those countries the public has the time to bother about those like kind of far-fetched and complicated issues. So out of those three, which one do you think is one a solution?
There's no silver bullet, let me say it like that. It probably depends where you are, what kind of aspect is more important than the other. NGOs, yes, to a certain extent, but we tried, for example, to get SODIS really distributed around the globe, and we had invested a lot of money to do so, it has its limits. It works in certain areas, but it doesn't absolutely not work in other areas. And it may not work because the NGOs don't really are so familiar with the local behavior of the people. So when you go to Africa, you first have to go to the old man of the village and talk to him. So actually the implementation is on the level of the women, but you have first to talk to the old men who don't understand anything at all, but are wise to be able to the women. You lose a lot of time. But that's kind of NGO areas, I would say. Privatization becomes yes and no. Also, I would say there are certain areas where privatization can actually bring a solution. In cities, normally, they will bring a solution for the drinking water if and only if the politics keep out of it. But I give you an example, a superb example of how not to do it, was Buenos Aires. You know, Menem, the president of Argentina, decided we're going to privatize everything, so this is great politically, and so said, now your French companies, you come in and you run our water system. They agreed on the price because the infrastructure had also to be entertained by the private sector, and then the people went into the street because the price tripled or quadrupled. Now every politician, I don't know a politician who stands up against the public in the streets. They crumbled. So the price was reduced. The government has said before, we are not subsidizing, it will run further. So they have not subsidized the amount of money which was now lacking, and then the private sector pulled out, crisis. So the private sector functions if really the economic environment is right to do it. If the politics interferes, it will go wrong. What was the third point?
The interference of the international community.
Yeah, the international community is kind of, we are running around now. We have almost a grassroots movement against globalization. And everything which is international, people are starting to get a little bit confused. Look in Europe what happens. You see what happened in the U.S. It's the same thing. We have international organizations. UN organizations who actually should deal with it. And when we look at the food area, FAO is there exactly to do that. They don't, because they are politicized. That's the issue. And I think what we have to think about are platforms, international platforms, which have no political links, but are really looking at the issue and dealing with the issue. Whether we will be ever able to do something, because somebody has to finance it. The moment you give the money, you have the power on it. I have the least belief in the international organization on the short term. I would say the private sector in certain areas is certainly a good solution, but the political environment has to be right. And for the poorer country, probably NGOs will still play a role. The problematic in the water sector is that the investments are very high. Now, poor people can pay the price for the water. They pay it already from the street vendor. They pay much more than the rich people in their own country. So poor people can pay. Poor people cannot invest. That means we have to have a mechanism where the investment is covered by national or international organization, but then they have to be managed in such a way that the people pay back the investments, and that doesn't really work. And one thing which I can tell you, unfortunately, out of my own experience, when the money number becomes too big, you will have all these mafia structures coming in your way. So all the projects, I always said, keep the projects below $100,000 per project. The moment you hit the million, it gets tricky. And you have mafia organization in all the countries, different ones, it's not all the same, and so, but you get mafia type of structures which actually see this big bucket of money and they will go after it.
Very good. Peter.
I wonder if there's some way between Roland's talking to the shamans and the modern city, we're not missing something. You did touch on it, and that is the powerful impact of water law, which seems to me can be a mediating factor if you have progressive law. The South African case is very interesting because the person who became the first Minister of Water Affairs was a very progressive lawyer, and he was able to change it in this way. And really, in terms of setting a research agenda, I wonder if it would be interesting to try and lay out water law and see where water law is conservative and destructive or where it is progressive.
It's this, Peter. I agree with you. It's government effectiveness. You can have the laws, but somebody has to look that it's implemented. And if it's not implemented, you can have the nicest law. You have, if you look into the laws of the old Soviet Union, it is very progressive and very positive. But the interpretation of the words were done differently. It was not implemented. It was just there in print, and that's it. I would say this is the issue. I agree with you. And South Africa is really a leader in that part. They have early on seen that, and actually Peter is from South Africa, they have early on seen that if you manage the water, you need the management on the government level, but then you have to manage the water, and if you manage it right, it will work. And they did a few very intelligent decisions along the way with this law. But the effectiveness of the government, if it's not there, it's not very helpful. Or we go back to the kings and the gods.
Okay, two last questions. First, Tony, and then John.
Thank you, Sasha. You showed the meat eaters and the vegans,
yeah.
Right? But of course, with increasing economic prosperity, and we've seen this in China, the meat content in the diet goes up.
Right.
So as we raise people out of poverty, more meat is eaten, which then impacts on all your equations.
Exactly.
And the second thing is, you talked about dams, but then we go into geopolitics. If the Chinese dam the headwaters of the Mekong, you have all that effect downstream in Cambodia, in Vietnam, and the food-producing areas there, or what if the Turks dam the Euphrates and the problems of the Jordan and so on. So how do we cope with all of those issues if we are moving to damming as one of the solutions?
Just an interesting remark to your first remark, basically. And I always like to use China because China is kind of in the shifting period, and China is probably moving much faster forward than we ever thought. You know, and we don't see it yet, but things are happening there. It was actually the strategy of the government, very clearly. We feed the people with the staple food. And with increasing GDP, we buy the meat from the outside. That was the basic assumption. That means China got richer, starts to have more meat produced locally, but also imported. There you can almost see it one-to-one, and it was, or still is, the policy of the government. The second thing, the dams, yes. I think you put the finger on a sore point. Dams are bad if they are not managed or badly managed. Dams are good if they are inclusive, the management is inclusive, and it takes the entire watershed into account. This is relatively difficult in rivers which go through different countries. Europe has managed, after 100 years of wars, to manage at least the Rhine correctly. I think that's a good example. It can be done. The problem is if you have situations like with Turkey, where the upstream country is a strong country with a strong military, and the downstreams are not, and then they control the water. But they are not interested in to give the water to them. Turkey is interested in to have influence in the downstream country. And the other thing around is in the Nile, where you have actually the strong countries, Egypt, and the weaker countries are upstream. So
Egypt will not allow Ethiopia to build dams, so they would. It would be actually make sense to have the dams up in Ethiopia because you have less water evaporation, and it would actually control partially also the erosion. Then to have it down in the Lake Nasser, where a lot of water is just evaporating in the air. Yes, you're right, but I think we are not even able to do it within a country. In multinational setting, it becomes a complication. But that doesn't mean that dams are per se something bad. It is only if they are not managed and managed right. They can do more harm than if you do nothing.
Okay, last question for John, and then we go to the coffee.
It's very interesting to see that from the water perspective, that the carrying capacity of for global population could well be 11 or 12 billion. I would say also the fact that in terms of, and quite rightly so, that the green water usage is high, and in agriculture, at present practice, it is very inefficient, even those for on the irrigated land, because they use sprinklers. I think if we move towards drip irrigation, then the productivity of in agriculture for water use will certainly goes up. And therefore, maybe we'll be thinking that therefore, in terms of the carrying capacity for global population could well be going to 15 billion and so forth. There's one constraint, and that is that to produce food, agriculture, the other important resource, which is a finite resource, is land. And I think land is not something that can be grown very easily. A lot of land arable has been polluted. It tends to be when sort of other human uses comes in, be it urbanization or industrialization, it's the first is to go is the arable land. So I think in terms of looking at the carrying capacity, I think we should be also looking at land, because for the car to move forward, the second wheel is land. So I think it is very exciting what you have written, but I would say that before we get carried away and say that we can have 15 billion population, then land is the constraint.
You didn't hear me saying the 15 billion. You said the 15 billion, because I know that the land is coming, is a limited resource. Let me go to the first part of your question. You say if we do it right and learn it right, we come actually to a higher water productivities. The 1 cubic meter per kilogram of wheat is actually the same data. This is efficient irrigation. These are the best irrigation things. And if you do the lab experiment, you come very close to that amount. So that seems is about the amount the normal plant needs for it. Now we can say we can genetically modify the plant so that actually the plant will actually may have more of the crop and so. But somewhere is the limit, you know. You cannot only have the crop and no leaves for collecting sunlight. So there is somewhere a limit, basically, to do it. And it seems, roughly, that 1 cubic meter per kilogram of wheat is close to, you may go to 1.1 or 1.2, depending on the plant characteristics and the climate condition, you can go there. I think this is close where we are. So normally in arable land, which is rain-fed, we are at 3 cubic meters. So this is what we heard, you know. We cannot control entirely the climatic conditions. The rain will fall when the rain falls, not basically when the crop is there. So this makes all that it becomes less efficient. That's actually the point. Now, with the land, I agree with you. If we think in agriculture as we have been doing it now since almost 10,000 years, agriculture is in its development further, in the sense that we are also able to start to produce large amounts of agriculture goods in almost synthetic soils. That means, yes, it would be great to have the natural soil with all the organic material in there and all the bacteria and all the animals living in the soil. But I think agriculture technologies and science is so far that actually if it comes really, it becomes problematic, they start to create soils. Look at the Dutch, you know. large parts of Europeans, tomato, whether they taste or not, that's a totally different story, but it's grown on stone wool. There's no organic matter anymore. It's just water, nutrient. I don't see that this will be covering all the staple food for 12 billion people. I agree with you. I would say if you go about above 10, it starts to get complicated because people have to live, and they live on arable lands, and that's what you don't want to. You want to keep the arable land. It is not simple. But what I wanted to show you is it's not simple, but we can find solution because physically we have the capacity. And now the rest is management, ideas, innovation, but it's not so that we are not able to solve this issue. This is my point.
Okay, on that optimistic note, I think we should thank Sasha for a great talk.